Born in Cairo and grew up in Delaware. We've had a good time the last couple of days talking about Delaware. Our two Delaware residents in the audience, or Delaware born in the audience with us. He majored in philosophy at Princeton, where he won several academic prizes, including the 2007 Dante Prize for the nation's best undergraduate essay on Dante. His senior thesis on sexual ethics won the Princeton Prizes for best thesis in ethics and best thesis in philosophy. Upon graduating Phi Beta Kappa and summa cum laude in philosophy in 2008, he went to earn a master's degree in moral, political, and legal philosophy at Oxford as a Rhodes Scholar. He's now pursuing his PhD in philosophy at Princeton and his JD at Yale University Law School. And his paper, What is Marriage?, co-authored with Robert George and Ryan Anderson, was published and quickly became, at that time, the most downloaded and copied paper in the Social Science Research Network. His sense has been turned into a book, What is Marriage, Man and Woman, a Defense? And in addition to publishing a number of contexts, he's given lectures and talks, he's engaged in debates, and we're pleased that he would take a bit of time from his busy schedule. As I mentioned, he's clerking in the DC District Court with a friend of the Wino, Tom Griffiths, Judge Tom Griffiths. And we're pleased to have Sherif with us to speak to the topic of marriage. Sherif. I forgot to remind you, these are being recorded, so if you could silence your phones and iPads, that would help. Thank you.
Thanks for the introduction. Thanks for having me. I'm a huge believer in Wheatley, and I'm a big believer in everything that Emily and Richard are doing. I think you're in fantastic hands here for the weekend, and those of you who are at BYU for the long haul. I thought I would do two things today. One is spend a little bit of time talking about general approaches to talking about really difficult issues with people who disagree with you. And then the second is to say a little bit about a traditional or conjugal view of marriage and of why it's really important, why it's true, and why living by it has benefits for all of society. Okay, so the first thing is just some general tips and some more specific techniques about how to have these debates in general. Think about the last time you talked about a really difficult political issue, for example, with a friend. Bull session in your dorm room, or a knockdown, drag-out fight in high school, or whatever it might be. Make sure that it's more than 3 months in the past. Okay? So you've thought of it. Now, how many substantive, specific points do you remember from that conversation? Do you remember the exact blow-by-blow? What they said, what you said, which objections were better than others, which ones went unrebutted? Probably not. Or maybe you remember two at most. But you certainly remember the tone and the tenor of the conversation. You remember what you felt that that person thought of you, and thought of these ideas, and thought of these issues. So the first and most general thing I would say is that tone matters. And the tone that you should strike is one of serene confidence and cheer. Serene confidence and cheer. On these issues, it's so hard to do that. And we easily get worked up and really believe in this stuff and we think it's really important. And for that reason, we get angry easily. We get sarcastic and cutting easily. And we lose debates that way. If you're trying to convince the person you are talking to, those attitudes are very destructive. Sometimes some form of that sort of happy warrior sparring attitude is useful for reinforcing the beliefs of others who are watching a debate. But if you're just talking to this person in front of you and you want them to think seriously about these issues and change their lives, then that's not the way to go. So how do you get serene confidence and cheer? I would say that the first thing is just to have the right goals when you're talking. If your goal is to win the argument, to make the other person weep, okay, which sometimes we all have, right? You won't have any rules, basically. And you'll be sarcastic, and you'll get worked up, and you'll let all of those passions fly. If your goal is to convince someone, to make them, not just to look like you won the interaction, but to really make them think differently about an issue, you'll be a little better. You'll be a little bit more careful about what you say. You'll take seriously the ideas. You won't take cheap shots. You won't hide from difficult points and try to dodge them, because that's a way of looking good. It's not a way of convincing someone. But even there, you might still have a kind of coldness about it. This is just an abstract issue, and I just want you to come to affirm at the end of the day, X, Y, Z. So a little better than wanting to win is wanting to convince. Even better than wanting to convince is wanting to improve someone's life, to help them see the good that you've seen. As a friend, to think, I have good news, and I've lived by it, and it has helped me, and I want the same for you. Because then you're going to naturally have the kind of attitude and the words and the tone and the approach that suggests to this person, you can trust me. You can hear me out. I'm not trying to beat you. I'm trying to draw you in. And I think the very best, so better to want to convince than to want to win, better to want to improve someone's life than simply to convince them. But I think the highest goal is a supernatural one, right? To give glory to God by loving this person in front of me. Because if you do that, you'll have even more benefits than the person who just wants to help. Because you'll have a supernatural perspective. You will have the longest game of long games in mind, and that will change your approach. It's very easy in these debates to lose hope and to give up, because you look at the short term and you think, there is no way we're going to win in the short term. And you think, humanly speaking, there might be no way we're going to win at all. And it's easy to get frustrated and then bitter and then cynical. But if you've got from the beginning a supernatural perspective, if you realize that every good effort bears some fruit, and that you're the one who plants the seed but not who gives the growth, that changes your attitude and your approach entirely. So the first thing is pretty simple, which is just to have the right goal for the conversation. The other thing is to be confident that this is the truth. And because it's the truth, there's a way to convincing someone. At least there are good arguments for it. Sometimes this is just a matter of striking the right first impression to draw somebody in. So when I was in law school, my first year of law school, in fact, the first week, I had to miss a class for a debate on same-sex marriage. And you know, I tried to make it up with the professor and so on, but when I came back a couple days later, one of my classmates said, oh, I didn't see you in class on Thursday. Now remember, this is Yale Law School, right? It's basically like a think tank for the ACLU. Everyone has one view and has it ferociously. And then there's like four or five of us who are really quiet and huddled and worried about it, okay? And I'm not a naturally sort of sparring personality, so at that time, especially, I was just trying to keep my head down, at least at school, at least have some friends there. She said, so you missed on Thursday? I said, yeah, I did. And she said, what did you miss for? You know, I'm already starting to think, what tack am I going to take? I said, well, a debate. She said, a debate about what? I said, a debate about marriage, same-sex marriage. And she said, and what view did you take? Kind of like, I know what you're going to say, because we're all at Yale Law School here. We all have the right views. So here was my decision point, right? I stop, and I'm thinking, and I just go for it. So with a big smile and energy, kind of assuming that she would think this, I said, against. And she paused, and then finally, you see a light bulb go off, and she says, was it one of those debates where you go and they just assign you a position to defend? I said, no, that's really what I think. And it's remarkable because just the way that I said it immediately drew her in. An interaction that could have ended in disaster, ended in more questions. Like, oh my, well, how did you come to this view? Do you have something I can read? Can we talk about it? By the end of the year, we had co-led a reading group for a whole semester on marriage and law and family that was with her and me and a lesbian married mother of two, and you know, and it was a remarkable experience. And it was all because I thought I had something good that was worth sharing. So she wanted to know what that was. She was totally thrown off balance by the fact that here was this conservative in the belly of the beast who thought he was right, and that there is something worth saying there. Now, how do you get that confidence? Well, one thing is to be assured that the arguments are out there. I can just tell you, I, for years, went around, you know, debating and defending this most hated conservative position on the most heated political issue at the most socially liberal law schools in the country. Probably scores of them. And you have nothing to worry about. There is a good argument for your vision of sex and marriage and family. So the first thing is just to know that it exists. There's one of the transformational moments for me in this respect was when I was in high school. A couple years before, I had this big moral and religious conversion. I had just become a Catholic. I really wanted to help other people see what I had seen. But I figured the only way to do that was to get them to accept the authority of the scriptures. You know, Jesus was walking around a couple days after he was dead, therefore, read this and believe what it says. It just wasn't even on my radar that any of the things that I came to believe as a Catholic were defensible by reason. And I came across this article online called God's Reasons. It was written by a guy named Robbie George at Princeton. And the article was about how this guy had the gall to think that you could defend conservative positions on life, on marriage, on religious liberty, on sex ethics, from reason alone. And that on those grounds, on that fair playing field, the traditional view could beat the secular liberal view. That was revolutionary to me. And just the idea that this guy who has this fancy chair at Princeton can say this in public and get away with it was itself encouraging. The arguments must be out there. And the rest is history in my case. So that's the first thing, know that it exists. The second thing is know that it hasn't been heard with most of the people you're going to be talking to. I always had this anxiety going into a discussion with a friend at Princeton, for example, that they've already heard all of this stuff, they already have a million reasons why they reject it, and as soon as I put myself out there, I'm just gonna be shot down. And nothing could be further from the truth. Novelty in this respect is your friend. People have very low expectations. They think that there is nothing to be said for your view. And the moment that you come out and constrain two English sentences together in very good grammar, and you can also, and you're not breathing fire out of your nostrils, they will be shocked and they'll listen. And for over several years, my co-authors and I have had hundreds of reactions in person, by email, by letters, people saying, I just never knew this stuff was out there. And you've caused me to think, including people who've gone whole hog from one side of the debate to the other because they had never even heard the argument. And once they did and they dug in and they tried to refute it, they came around to believing and defending it. So know the arguments are out there. Be confident that they haven't been tried. So there's work for you to do. And then, of course, prepare. You can prepare. Today, it's a lot easier to prepare than it would have been 20 years ago because you just have so many resources at your fingertips. Online, for example, I'll put a plug in for my co-author, who's the editor of a journal called Public Discourse, which every day runs an article a little bit more than an op-ed, a little bit less than an academic article, maybe 1,000, 1,500, 2,000 words at most, explaining and defending in rational terms one of the principles or policies or positions that you and I very likely share, and doing it with finesse and with talent and drawing on the very best resources intellectually that are out there. Read that stuff. Practice talking about an issue. Practice first with friends. Just saying it out loud makes a huge difference for saying it out loud a second time. So know it's out there, trust that it hasn't been heard yet, and then prepare, mainly by practicing. The second thing I would say is that besides cheerful confidence and serenity, which you get first of all from having the right goal, and then second of all from being confident that this is the truth, there are arguments for it, and then absorbing them. There are some specific techniques, you know, tactics more than strategies. So one is, make sure that you're playing offense and not just defense the whole time. The worst thing that can happen is that you find yourself in an hour-long conversation entirely spent on you explaining why you're not a bigot. Okay, that's hopeless. Very often in these debates, because you're talking to people who've never met a conservative, you're talking to people, all of their friends and their mentors, every smart person they've ever met thinks the same way on a particular issue, they don't feel like they have to defend the whole thing. All they have to do is poke a hole in the wall that you're trying to build, this whole vision of the human person and sex and marriage and family and law and the common good. And all they have to do is go, what about this part? Or why that? That's an unfair fight. If you really want to have a serious conversation with someone and you have the time and the opportunity, it's a friendship or whatever, make sure that it's apples to apples. Make sure that they first tell you what they think, not what they reject. You're talking about marriage, the marriage debate. Why do you draw the line at, you know, wherever you draw it, opposite sex couples or two people or whatever? You just first get their view on the table and say, well, you know, I'm happy to talk about that, but I just want to know what you think marriage is and what you think the limits of it are and why you think the limits are there and not elsewhere. Just get your view on the table. Even get them to defend it just a little bit, and they'll start to see how hard it is to give a serious, tight, not question-begging argument on these issues. And when they try to do that, and they realize their own view has soft spots, has weak spots, and they realize how hard it is to give an argument, even for some of the things you might share, they will be much more open to hearing your argument. And they'll appreciate the force of an argument that works, given how hard it is to explain any of this stuff on either side. Okay, so play offense and not just defense. And then the second thing is very obvious, but it's hard to keep in mind when you're doing this, is just start with common ground and leverage it. A lot of people say much more extreme things than they believe on these issues. Sex ethics, for example, premarital sex. If you talk to your typical secular liberal student on a university campus today, and you say, well, what do you think are the norms governing sex? They'll go, oh, well, anything goes, and it's all fine as long as you're not physically hurting someone and, you know, violating consent. The truth is, nobody believes that. If you say to them, oh, okay, so you're saying there's nothing unhealthy or unfortunate or wrong or no missed opportunity if I have the same attitude towards sex that I have towards tennis or basketball. You know, every day I want to go see who's willing to have a pickup game. You know, whatever stranger walks by. You're saying there's no loss in having that kind of attitude about sex. Most people, if they're honest, will say, well, I mean, you know, I guess, you know, it could mean less than when you try to have it in a relationship, or, you know, why do you not treat it that way? If you can put it even just in those limited terms, people will start to say the kinds of things, to cite the kinds of goods that traditional norms on sex and marriage serve better than the norms they profess. So you can show them that they already get sex is different. Sex is somehow special. And if you use it in the way that you would use just any other activity, you're missing something. That's a modest premise, but it's a premise you can work with. And you can start to ask, why is that true of sex, if it's just another pleasing activity? It's just another contact sport, as George Weigel puts it. Why? What is special about it? And once we get it on the table, what's special about it? Well, where's the line that we have to draw to preserve what's special about it. If what's special about it is that it's a way of really giving yourself to another, a kind of complete dedication of one person to another, well then, is that really compatible with going from boyfriend or girlfriend to boyfriend or girlfriend, and having a kind of serial monogamy about sexual relationships? You can start to work with what they share. In the marriage debate, that's another way to go. You can start even with very simple premises, like why should marriage be a romantic relationship? What's special about those that explains why only romantic relationships get this special category, this special status? It's actually much harder to explain if you have a kind of typical liberal view of these issues today. So let me dive a little bit more into that then. A little bit more. I think that in the marriage debate generally, and I'm going to be focusing not on the political and legal issues, partly because I'm on a clerkship and I'm not supposed to talk directly about those. I know it's a total farce. All the professional ethics rules are ridiculous. You can Google me and know exactly what I think about a lot of things. But whatever, for this year, I am not going to talk about it. I'm just going to talk about this as a cultural and moral issue, as a question about what societies look like when they live by one or another view of marriage. And I think it's useful to think in terms of two competing visions of marriage. What I'll be calling the conjugal view, that's the traditional view, and the revisionist view, because it wants to revise, to put it lightly, the traditional norms. All right, but let's start with the revisionist view, and let's give it its most sympathetic rendering, okay? You want to understand your opponents as sympathetically as possible, because then you'll be talking to them and not past them. So, on a revisionist view, on your typical sort of everyday person on the street liberal view of marriage, what is it that makes marriage special? You know, if you've got two guys, they're living together, they share a home, they're kind of committed to it for the long haul, let's say, what determines whether what they have is a marriage or a long-term friendship, roommate kind of situation? Well, it's a certain kind of deep emotional union, right? These are not just two people who happen to share resources, who happen to share a roof. They are people who have pledged themselves to each other in a deeply emotionally involved relationship, usually romantic. So it's a relationship that's marked partly by romance and partly just by its depth. You feel more strongly about this person than about anyone else. This is the person that you want to, you know, be your first go-to person for advice, for consolation and defeats, for celebration in your victories, the person who knows what time your plane's gonna land and makes sure to call you if you don't get there on time, all of that. Okay, fine. So it's a deep emotional union. Okay, let's work with that. Let's see whether it can explain other things most people believe that marriage is. For example, can it explain why marriage is a permanent commitment? If what makes this relationship a marriage and not just another friendship is itself a kind of emotional charge that could go away, does it make any sense to think of marriage as a permanent commitment as opposed to a sort of long-term but renewable lease? Right? Like, you know, you can check back with me in 5 years, we'll see if the feeling is still there. If not, if we've just reverted to a friendship, well then it makes no sense to stick this out. I think this vision cannot explain why marriage is or even should aspire to be permanent, because the thing that makes it a marriage is not itself guaranteed to be permanent. I don't think it can explain exclusivity. When people defend contemporary liberal views on marriage, they still say, well, you know, what's special is that it's one person committed to them for the long haul, forsaking all others. You know, it's permanent and exclusive. Why should it be exclusive on this view? If what makes it a marriage is a deep emotional union and satisfaction, then for people for whom that's fostered by exclusivity, great. But for people for whom it's not, maybe exclusivity creates tensions and jealousies and sort of difficulties in the relationship. In which case, an open relationship would be better. It would better serve the very thing that makes this a marriage. And if that sounds unrealistic to you or just some kind of philosopher's hypothetical, you need to read more. You need to get out more. In my world, in academic philosophy, for example, there are lots of people who are defending as a matter of principle and living out and boasting of sexually open relationships. They say this is actually a much more stable form of relationship. It creates much more of a bond. We can be more honest and open with each other. And this fosters companionship for us. Now, whether they're right about that idea or not, whether it really does make it easier for them to stay together or not, that's not a marriage. That's something else. And most people on both sides of the debate will still agree on that. But if they have the revisionist view, they will not be able to explain it. So permanence is hard to explain. Exclusivity is hard to explain. Monogamy, the idea that this should be a union of two and only two people. That it can't be, for example, a trio who are all in love with each other, deeply emotionally attached to each other, committed to each other for the long haul. They share all their property. They share a home. They want all three names on the tax filing. They want to raise kids together. They don't want to be stigmatized. They don't want their kids to be stigmatized. Right? Every argument for revising the definition of marriage somewhat will apply equally to them. Because what makes it an emotional, what makes it a marriage is an emotional bond. Well, three people can have that as well as two. And yet, again, most people on both sides think, no, there's something special about two. But their own vision of marriage can't explain it. Permanence, exclusivity, monogamy. I think even the idea that marriage is inherently a sexual relationship starts to look arbitrary on this view. Yeah, for a lot of people, that's going to be a really emotionally intense experience, and for that reason, it will really foster emotional depth for them. But you can imagine scenarios of deep emotional depth where that doesn't happen. People who identify today as asexual, but even setting that aside, you can have deep companionship and deep emotional union and satisfaction without sex. In fact, between people who might not even want to have sex in the picture, people who are just very close friends, or people who are related to each other, but who have shared their lot in life, who want to throw in together for the long haul. If what makes it a marriage is emotional depth, then sex is just as arbitrary a line to draw as any other. This is basically a vision of marriage which, when you press on it just a little bit, collapses the category of marriage into companionship in general. It can't explain any of the features that set marriage apart from other forms of companionship, where you can share it with, you can have companions or more than two, you don't have to be companions with only one person, you don't have to be have a sexual component to the companionship, and so on. So you can start with ideas that people share, values that people share on marriage, and show them that some other part of their vision of marriage can't explain that. And if you have the long-term opportunity to do this over several conversations with a friend, for example, or over a series of op-eds or pamphlets or whatever other context it is, by this point in the conversation, you have opened people up. They're now in the market for a defense of even their own vision of marriage. So they're open to hearing arguments, affirmative arguments, not just critical ones, that they might not have been open to at the beginning of the conversation. All right, so what can fill in that blank? What vision of marriage can explain permanence and exclusivity and monogamy and sexual union and a kind of principled connection to kids and family life and through that to the common good? Well, in the book that was mentioned, my co-authors and I describe this as the conjugal view of marriage. We also describe it as a comprehensive union. We think that is one way, not the only way, one way of getting at the core concept, which in a lot of religious traditions is the idea of one flesh union, for example, that core concept that explains all the different features of marriage. So what do we mean by it, though? Well, you can think of any form of relationship, any form of community, as characterized by common activity towards common ends in the context of a commitment. And we think it's in those three respects that the community we call marriage is comprehensive. All right? So first, let me just give a different model. Common activity, common ends, and a commitment. How are those the shaping and defining features of any form of community? Well, think of an academic community. You've got BYU, you've got the Wheatley Institution. Any group of people who have bonded together for the sake of knowledge and truth and understanding. There's their common ends. That's what defines them as a community, as an intellectual or academic community. The common activities that aim towards those ends are research, writing, publication, seminars, instructions, learning, teaching, tutoring. Those activities are the things that make them the kind of community that they are, because they're oriented towards the common ends that define this community. And because you have goods in view and activities that serve those goods, you need to protect both with certain kinds of commitments, certain norms for the community. And in this case, that would be things like very strong norms against plagiarism, strong norms against deceit, strong norms in favor of following the argument where it leads, putting all the information on the table, not discounting inconvenient facts. So you've got intellectual community, it's defined by activity towards ends with a commitment. Same thing with marriage, except in each of those respects, it's comprehensive. What does that mean? Well, take the kind of unifying activity. One defining feature of marriage is sexual union. And in that defining activity, you've got union that's comprehensive in the sense that it is a union at all levels with the beloved. Not just heart and mind, like in an intellectual community, but heart, mind, and body. Most people will agree with that description, just stated that generally. Yeah, there's something about, it's like my whole self to the other, total self-gift in some religious traditions, but you don't have to use those terms. Most people, secular included, will get that. And they'll get that bodily union is in the picture, and they'll even get that sex has something to do with the bodily union. But now what explains that link? Why is it some kind of sexual activity that produces one flesh union, or bodily union, or total self-gift? It can't just be that it feels really intense. Because that'll get us right back where we started. Other activities together can feel really intense, can really foster a deep emotional connection. Can't just be that. So what is it? Well, we think you can understand bodily union between two people by analogy to the union within a single person. So the reason the different parts of me are one body, are one flesh, is that they're all working together towards a common bodily end of the whole, which is my survival. And that radical kind of bodily union is possible between two people, but only in one respect, only with respect to one bodily end, which is reproduction. So in the marital act, in sexual intercourse, a man and a woman themselves, like the parts of a single person, are coordinating towards a common bodily end of the whole. Bodily end is reproduction, and the whole is the couple. It's the couple that is being reproduced. So that's the sense in which marriage, understood as a union of a man and a woman, can involve a union at all levels, heart, mind, and body. The second sense in which marriage is comprehensive is in the unifying goods, right? Intellectual community, we said, kind of aims towards some human goods, knowledge and truth and understanding. You can have a sports community, a team, I guess is the word. I'm as athletic as you think I am, so this is not my forte. But you have a sports, an athletic team that's oriented towards the goods of athletic performance, of skillful performances, of health and activity and play. Okay? But the union of marriage is not just oriented towards intellectual goods, not just oriented towards athletic goods. Somehow, it's kind of oriented to all of these things at once. And that's why you live together. That's where you share a range of activities. And the reason that's true is that it's somehow oriented to creating not just this or that good, but whole new human beings, new participants in every one of those goods. All right, if you say that, there's some special connection between marriage and family life, most people will agree with you. And they'll say, yeah, that's why we need adoption rights and so on. But if you press, say, what explains that connection? You'll get them stuck. Most likely they'll say something like, well, it's just the fact that you decide to have that kind of relationship. That doesn't quite capture it because other groupings of adults can decide to band together and raise a kid. We wouldn't think of that as a marriage. We wouldn't think of it as having the connection to family life that marriage has. Marriage seems connected to family by its nature. Well, the conjugal view can explain that. On the conjugal view of marriage, the very activity that sets marriage apart is itself oriented to family life. In other words, the very activity that makes marital love, that seals the bond of man and woman as a marriage, also makes new life. So the relationship itself that's embodied in that act is also oriented to the creation of new life and its bearing and its rearing and its formation in every dimension of life. So it's comprehensive in uniting the spouses in heart, mind, and body. That thing is valuable in itself already, even before kids come along. But when they do, it's drawing their union out into a wide range sharing of goods in that horizontal sense. And finally, if a union is comprehensive in those two senses, in the dimensions of the partners united, in the range of life activities that unite them, then it's going to be comprehensive in the commitment that it calls for to protect those goods. Comprehensive commitment through time means permanence, and at each time means exclusivity. So there you've got permanence and exclusivity and sexual union and romance, and through that, a connection to family life, and through those things to the common good. All of the features that the revisionist view of marriage can't explain, and in fact tends to undermine, this view of marriage explains and unifies and reinforces and gives a kind of intelligibility to. At this point in the conversation, people will do a number of things. One is they might say, I see what you did there. You just use different terms for the Bible's ideas. You called it comprehensive union, blah, blah, blah. It's really one flesh. You even said it yourself. You just got this from Genesis, and you took a year of your life to figure out how to dress it up in philosophical terms. You're being dishonest. And I say to them, you think whatever you want to think about me. Sure, I'm being dishonest, I'm really a bigot and a religious zealot who's just peddling this philosophical, whatever. But you will still have something to explain, which is the fact that this is not just the vision of marriage you get in canon law, but in the common law. It's not just the vision of marriage in the Jewish and Christian and Muslim traditions, but in the thought of ancient Greek and Roman thinkers who had no connection to Judaism or Christianity or any of these sources. People like Plato and Aristotle and Socrates and Xenophanes and Musonius, Rufus and Plutarch, all these folks who never touched a Bible, they have no idea what a Hebrew prophet looks like. St. Paul did not write letters to their hometown, and yet they have a remarkably similar vision of sex and marriage. I would recommend the work of John Finnis on this issue. He has a couple articles that detail this, and it's kind of stunning. And even if you've read those folks, you might not have noticed these resonances. It's incredible. So the fact of the matter is you cannot explain this simply as a matter of religion or theology. Of course, there are deep theological roots and glosses on this, and I think that they can deepen our understanding of these goods, but these goods have also been understood by people just working philosophically. That's the first thing. Then they'll say, okay, fine, well, but it surely is just traceable to bigotry. It's today, and maybe even in the past, it was motivated by a kind of disgust for other ways of life, especially for example, the LGBT community. And there again, I don't care what they think about me. They can think I'm a bigot. They think my motives are X, Y, Z. But but they will still have something to answer. Which is why something remarkably like this vision of marriage emerged in cultures that span the spectrum of attitudes towards homosexuality. In cultures that had nothing like our concept of gay identity to see a class of people to be bigoted towards. In cultures in which, for example, in ancient Greece, same-sex sexual activity was widely practiced across the board. It wasn't even just a particular group. And by the general culture, it was seen as perfectly fine. And yet, they had a totally different vision of what made a marriage. So you can't explain it just by theology. You can't explain it just by animus towards any particular group. History blows up both of those diagnoses, whatever they think about you or me. So they've still got a challenge to meet. Then the next thing they might say is, well, all right, fine, whatever. I'll grant you as an abstract point that this stuff, maybe, you know, there's some kind of rational argument to be made for it. Maybe I'll even grant you, just for today, just for now, that it's true. That's what makes marriage special. Why do you care? Why do you care what other people think? Why do you care what other people live by? And here, we can point to real-world concrete effects. This is not just an abstract matter. Forget about opposite sex versus same sex. Just think of an opposite sex couple. Imagine one of them that lives by the revisionist view. One of them that lives by the conjugal view. Or even better yet, imagine cultures that are totally shaped, one by that view, one by the other. Now think of a young boy growing up in a revisionist culture versus a conjugal vision of marriage. If that boy is taught from day one by all the institutions of his culture, by all his friends, by all his mentors, that what makes it a marriage is a deep emotional commitment that might go away, that mothers and fathers are perfectly replaceable. In fact, that it is bigotry to think otherwise, and it's inauthentic to stick with a marriage when that feeling wanes. Is he going to be more or less likely to stick with a marriage when the going gets tough? To stay with his wife through hard times because his kids need their father, need a father and a mother? Those questions answer themselves. The vision you live by, the ideas you have will shape how you live. And if you think of marriage as this kind of emotional connection for the personal satisfaction of the partners, with only a kind of contingent and distant relationship to all these other social goods, you're going to live accordingly. It will be harder for you to live out permanence and exclusivity. You will have a harder time seeing the point of doing that, seeing why these things need to hang together. Of course, you're still going to have the sort of doe-eyed sort of sentimental goals when you first come in, because romance and attraction and eros will be doing their thing. But when the rubber meets the road, when you really have to make a decision, when you're not just being carried by your passions, it will make a difference what you believe about marriage. And it'll make a difference not just to you, but to your partner, and not just to your partner, but to kids, and not just to those kids, but to the rest of society that has to foot the bill when the parents of those children aren't doing their job. These ideas have consequences, broken hearts and homes, and wider social consequences beyond those. So this stuff is not just rooted in bigotry, it's not just rooted in a particular theology, and it matters. And how we live, by which vision of marriage and sex we live by, matters to ourselves and to others. And the work of people like Mary, who have chronicled the concrete real-world effects of the sexual revolution, the toll, the human toll that it has taken on families, on kids who then grow up and are afraid of commitment themselves, have seen what happens when these things end in disaster, is real. And people who will not at first be moved by these general arguments will be drawn in by those real-world concrete effects. So very often the best thing to do is to give them a book by Mary Ebersat, and then to work them from there to the principles that explain these differences. All right, if we can agree that it's bad that we live in a world where pornography has disabled men from having real-life relationships with women, if we can agree that it's bad for kids to be torn apart by the divorce of their parents at a young age, if we can agree that it's bad for people to be atomized and isolated and for communities to break down because they're built on families which are built on marriages that break down, if we can agree on those things, let's work from there. Why are those things bad? And why are those things happening? What visions of marriage and sex and the human person are making those happen? And that's a way to lead people into the truth, because it's not just a way of shaming them into having to produce an argument, but it's a way of helping them see why they should care about the truth in this realm. So that's a kind of overview of the goals you should have, of the approach that you should take, of the techniques that will help you in the nitty-gritty, and of the big picture of what vision we want to paint for our friends, for strangers, for people who, because they're other human beings, deserve to know the truth and live by it. Thanks.